Welcome everyone. We are going to complete our lectures on microwave engineering based on the textbook Microwave Engineering by D.M. Ogusar, the 4th edition. In this lecture, we are going to start Chapter 10, and Chapter 10 is titled Noise and Nonlinear Distortion. These lectures are presented by Professor Ahmed Muhammad Atiyah, the head of Microwave Engineering Department at Electronics Research Institute. If you wish to contact with me, you can use this email. At the beginning, we are going to introduce what is the noise in microwave systems. And we say that the effect of the noise is critical to the performance of most RF and microwave communication radar systems and remote sensing systems. Because noise is ultimately determines the threshold for the minimum signal that can be reliably detected by the receiver. To understand this situation, let us imagine that you are in a supermarket, for example, and this supermarket is crowded, and you are listening to many voices, and someone is talking to you, and his voice is very is very little, or it is not clear. So if the signal of the voice of the person who want to talk to you is less than the signals surrounding you, in this case you will not determine the signal which should be received from the predicted person. This is an example for the noise. This noise in this case is audio noise. In a similar case, for microwave systems like radars, microwave communication systems, remote sensing, and so on, we are surrounded by random microwave signals. So if the signal of the microwave communication systems or radar or remote sensing is less than these random signals, we cannot detect the desirable signal. And this random signal is known as the noise signal. Noise power in a receiver will be introduced from external environment through the receiving antenna, exactly as in the same way in the audio. The noise or audio noise, it will be received from your ear. So noise power in the receiver will be introduced from external environment through the receiving antenna, as well as it can be generated internally from the receiver circuit itself. For example, your heartbeats, they have little bit of sound, but if you are in a very clean area without any sounds around you, you can hear your heartbeat yourself. Your heartbeat in this case represents internal noise or internal audio noise. In a similar way, the receiver circuits, the receiver circuits themselves introduce random signals at the output of the receiver. This random signal, which is created inside the receiver circuit, they are called internal noise in the receiver circuit. So we have two types of noise: external noise, and this external noise is coupled to the receiver through the antenna, or it can be coupled from other coupling methods, and internal noise coming from the circuit of the receiver itself. Here we will study the sources of the noise. So what is the source of external noise and internal noise in RF and microwave systems, and the characterization of components in terms of noise temperature, noise figure, and the effect of impedance mismatch. So these are the main topics which we are going to create in this chapter. What is the source of this noise? What's the mean of the noise temperature or equivalent noise temperature, which is not effective or actual temperature, but is effective temperature? What is meant by noise figure? And what is the effect of the impedance mismatch of the circuit on the noise of the complete circuit? As a beginning, we should note that the noise has some other problems which are related to the noise, such as the gain compression, the harmonic distortion. Gain compression means that if I have an amplifier, for example, and I'm increasing the input signal, the output signal will be increased linearly at a certain portion, and after a while, this gain will be saturated. At such saturation, this saturation will introduce some sort of noise, and this saturation is called gain compression. Harmonic distortion. If I have two signals with close frequencies, and these two signals are input to the same amplifier, there will be some multiplication between the two signals, introducing the harmonics of these two signals. This is called harmonic distortion, and we will see how to study the effect of this harmonic distortion. Also, intermodulation distortion. Intermodulation distortion, as in the previous case, in the harmonic distortion, there will be generated the harmonics of the signals. In the intermodulation distortion, there will be introduced some modulation effect between the two signals. This will introduce something called dynamic range. And effectively, the dynamic range of any microwave circuit or any microwave receiver is a critical parameter for such microwave circuit or microwave receiver. This dynamic range represents what is the minimum power and the maximum power which can be used for such microwave receiver or microwave circuit. And effectively, the concept of the dynamic range is the main target of our chapter here. And by the end of this chapter, we are going to calculate the dynamic range based on different aspects. So, we are keeping in your mind the dynamic range of a receiver is the main target for the study of the nonlinearity and noise in microwave circuits. These parameters or these topics can have important limiting effect on the large signal level for mixers, for example, amplifiers and other components, and also at the very small signal level. So this can have important limiting effect when large signal levels are present in mixers, amplifiers and other components that use nonlinear devices such as diodes and transistors. Let us start with the noise in microwave circuits. We say that the noise power is a result from random process such as the flow of charges, holes in electron tubes or solid-state devices, propagation through ionosphere or other ionized gas. Actually, if we have any moving charges and these moving charges are moving in random way, this random motion will introduce in somehow random radiation, and this random radiation will introduce random noise power. Most basic of all, thermal vibration. Effectively, the random motion of these charges is mainly due to the thermal vibration. So most basic of all, the thermal vibrations in any component at the temperature above absolute zero. And absolute zero here, we are talking about the absolute temperature in kelvins. So, any circuit, and effectively any circuit is used above the absolute zero, has a random motion for the free charges, and this random motion will introduce some noise inside the circuit. Noise can be passed into microwave system from external sources or generated within the system itself. So, we have external noise and we have internal noise. External noise is the noise coming from outside the system and enter inside the system through a coupling or through the antenna. On the other hand, internal noise is introduced inside the microwave circuit itself. In either cases, the noise level of the system sets the lower limit on the strength of the signal that can be detected in the presence of the noise. As I said, if the signal is less than the noise level, I cannot detect the signal. So, the received signal by the receiver or the microwave circuit, the input signal should be slightly greater than the noise level, and at the same time, when it has been amplified inside the circuit, at the output, it should be greater than the output noise level. And we will see that the output noise is greater than the input noise, because in the output noise, we are getting the internal noise, the external noise amplified by this microwave circuit in addition to the internal noise. So the output noise is usually greater than the input noise. So to detect the signal at the output, it should be greater than the output noise. In general, it is desired to minimize the residual noise level for the reader or communication receiver to achieve the best performance. So, in general speaking, it is required to minimize the noise level as much as possible. However, in some cases, for example, in radio meters or radio astronomy, actually, the required signal is effectively the external noise. Because one sort of the external noise is the noise, as I said, in the ionosphere, is the noise coming from the astronomy. So, when we are talking about radio meters or radio astronomy, we are actually interested in what is the value of the external noise. In this case, it is required to minimize the internal noise to detect the value of the external noise, which represents the noise of the ionosphere or the noise of the galaxy, for example. So, in some cases, such as radio meters or radio astronomy, the desired signal is actually the external noise bar. Here, noise, it is the external noise bar received by the antenna. And in this case, it is necessary to distinguish between the received noise bar and the undesired noise generated by the receiver system itself. So, actually, in radio astronomy or radio meters, what we are measuring is the noise. But in this case, I am not interested in the internal noise of the receiver. So, I am interested only in the external noise. In this case, the internal noise of the receiver must be much, much less than the external noise to distinguish between the external noise and the internal noise. The dynamic range, as I said, is a very important character for any microwave circuit or receiver. Actually, it determines what is the minimum power that can be used by this receiver and what is the maximum power that can be used by this receiver. So, the difference between the maximum power and the minimum power is called is the dynamic range. And as I said, the dynamic range is the main target of our all discussion in this chapter. And by the end of this chapter, we are going to see how to calculate the dynamic range for a specific receiver set. Here we are going to define what is the dynamic range because of the noise generated by the amplifier itself. Some non-zero noise power will always be delivered to the amplifier even if the input power is zero. So assume that if I have amplifier, for example, and I have a matched load at the input, so there is no power in the input, I can see that in the output there is some still signal, some signal. This signal is due to the generated noise inside the amplifier itself. On the other extreme, at very large power signal, at very high input power, the amplifier will be non-linear, and at certain value, the amplifier will be breaking down, so there will be failure for the amplifier. So effectively, we have three regions. A region where the input signal is less than the noise floor, and in this case, I cannot discriminate between the signal and the noise. And the region between the noise floor and the starting of the nonlinearity in the relation of the amplifier. This is called the linear region. And effectively, in this linear region, we can use the amplifier as an amplifier. After this linear region, we reach to nonlinear region and we reach to failure of the amplifier. And in this region, there will be gain compression, intermodulation, harmonic distortion, everything about the losses in the nonlinear. So, at the other extreme, very high input power will cause the amplifier to fail. At very low input power, at very low input power level, the output will be dominated by the noise generated by the amplifier, which is called the noise floor. So, the noise floor of the component system. Noise floor, in general speaking, it can be in the range from minus 80 dBm to minus 140 dBm. dBm here, it means dB with respect to 1 milliwatt. So, effectively, 0 dBm corresponds to 1 milliwatt. 10 dBm corresponds to 10 milliwatt. 20 dBm, it will correspond to 100 milliwatt. So 1 dBm correspond to 0 dBm corresponds to 1 milliwatt. So, if you are talking about minus 80 dBm, it means that 1 milliwatt multiplied by 10 to the power minus 8. Minus 140 dBm, it means that 1 milliwatt multiplied by 10 to the power minus 14. Okay? So, generally speaking, the noise floor is in the range from minus 80 dBm to minus 140 dBm, depending on the bandwidth of the operating bandwidth of the system and the mechanism of the noise inside the system itself. Above the noise floor, the amplifier will have a range, the input power and the output power has a linear relation such that the output power equals the value of the gain of the amplifier. If this is an amplifier, it would be the gain is greater than unity. If it is an attenuator, the gain it would be less than unity. In terms of dB, if this an amplifier, the value of gain in dB it would be positive. If it is an attenuator, the value of gain in dB it would be negative. So the output bar it would be G multiplied by BN in linear relation or in linear region. In dB, the output power in dBm, it would be the gain in dB plus the input power in dBm. And it should be noted here, if we are talking in terms of dB, the output power and input power, it would be represented in dBm. But the gain is a ratio, it is not dBm, it would be dB. So, the output power in dBm, it would be the gain in dB plus the input power in dBm. And effectively, the gain in dB is some constant. So, the relation between the output power and the input power in dB or in the log scale, in this case, it would be a slope of, it would be aligned with the slope of unity. Because here, the output power in dBm is linearly proportional to the input power in dBm and the proportionality factor is unity. G here, it would be just shifting value. So, if this scale in log scale, we find that this value or we are shifting this scale to the value of G and then the slope here, it would be unity. So, increasing 10 dB in this case it would be increasing 10 dB in this case and so on. Alright? So, above the noise floor, the amplifier will have a range of input power, which V output equals G multiplied by Vn, which is closely approximated. And this is a usable dynamic range. This is the range. It's called the dynamic range. Where the amplifier is a linear relation. At the upper end of this linear relation, at the upper end of this range, the output will begin to saturate. meaning that the output power will no longer increase linearly as the input power increases. So the linear relation here has been lost at this region. This is called gain compression. And after gain compression, it would be completely flat, such that if I increase the input power, the output power will not be increased anymore. And after this, the amplifier will be broken down, and this is called the failure. So excessive input power will lead to the failure of the amplifier. So effectively, the range of working of the amplifier is the linear range only, and this is called the dynamic range. So this is the maximum power, the maximum input power, and this is the minimum input power, or in other words, this is the maximum output power and this is the minimum output power. So the difference between in dB, the difference between the maximum power and minimum power, it would be defined as the dynamic range. This is a simple definition for the dynamic range, but as I said, the dynamic range is not so simple like this. So now we have defined what is the noise. We have defined briefly what is the dynamic range. In the next video, we are going to talk about what are the sources for the internal noise and what are the sources of the external noise. So see you in the next video to complete this lecture, to see what are the sources of this noise in the microwave circuits. Okay. All right.